And she's the co-founder of the studio Geil Danke in Berlin. If you want to talk to her about something outside of development and design, I think she's into baking because she has some great creations on her Instagram feed. And apparently she loves Buffy the Vampire Slayer, if I'm not wrong. Her talk, though, is going to talk about the responsibility that comes with the power that we have by introducing virtual reality into our apps or build apps on virtual reality. Because I don't know if you have tried virtual reality, but it's really easy to make people feel physically ill and get really sick. So with the power that you get by immersing people in a virtual world, you also have the responsibility to be really careful that you don't harm them and give them motion sickness, phobia, seizures, or other things. So Michaela is going to talk from the user-centered perspective of virtual reality on the web, and I'm really excited about her talk. So give her a very big applause and a warm welcome, Michaela.
Thank you. Oh, okay. I don't know. Thank you. Hi. As she already said, my name is Michaela, and I'm here to talk about web VR. So, reading the topic of my talk, you might have thought, a web in 3D? Isn't that nonsense? And isn't thinking and talking about a virtual reality web nothing more than ridiculous? Or most of all, should I even care about virtual reality? As you may have guessed it already, you're right. I'm here today to tell you that you should care about web VR and virtual reality. Even if you are not a gamer, or even if you're just not into that virtual reality stuff, or even if VR constantly makes you feel sick. Why, you ask? Because if this technology is permanent, and at the moment it looks like it is, because virtual reality will have a great impact on our users. And we all agree that we should care about our users, aren't we? Okay, this is why I will tell you the most important facts about VR and web VR you have to know as a developer to create responsible virtual reality experiences. We will begin with some brief general information about VR, its concepts, and the hardware. And then we'll have a look into the web VR API and some libraries that make working with web VR easier. And afterwards, I'll tell you about the topic I'm most passionate about, a good user experience in web VR applications. Okay, before I forget, you can all download the slides with the links and the credits, and I will tweet the URL after my talk. Okay, since we do not have unlimited time, I won't talk about what virtual reality is in general. And I also won't talk about why I think VR matters. Instead, I want to concentrate on the things we as developers need to know when creating VR applications. So let's start with a super simple question. When does it make sense to create a VR web application? What is VR good at? Virtual reality is really good for understanding spatial relationships, and this is because our human brains are designed for understanding space and how objects relate to each other in a 3D space. Which leads to another thing VR is really good at. VR is good for multitasking. Organizing tasks spatially can lead really to a massive productivity gain. And finally, virtual reality and also augmented reality are really good for simulations. Because a 3D world enables the user to develop a deep connection with what he or she experienced. And this is why VR not only is good to create empathy or being used for therapy, VR and AR can both be used to simulate, for example, fake limbs, or enhance our senses. There are examples where people quite quickly are adapting to a third arm or even a 360-degree view. So that all sounds great, doesn't it? Yeah, but let's be clear, VR is not the solution for everything. At the moment, for example, VR should definitely not be used if you have a lot of text that should be legible. And also, we mostly have no tactile feedback, which may cause confusion in 3D space for a user or even bring them out of balance. Yeah, like this. Okay, now that we know what VR enables and what its limits are, we need to know about the hardware and the concepts of virtual reality if you do not want to exclude users. So let's start with a brief look at the hardware. We can differentiate between three sorts of VR devices. First, we have mobile VR devices, which are basically smartphones with a relatively cheap headset with magnifying lenses. The input methods on these devices vary. We have on the left the Google Cardboard, which only has a button on the side. Then there's the Samsung Gear VR in the middle, for example, which has a button and a touchpad on the side and can also be used with a special VR remote controller. And there's the Google Daydream View on the right side, which comes with a special remote controller with three buttons, volume controls, and a touchpad. Then there are also desktop VR devices, which are significantly more expensive because the headset also contains the sensor and the displays. And the computing power comes from the desktop computer or the gaming console to which the VR devices are plugged. There are also special controllers for each device. For example, the Oculus Rift comes with Oculus Touch motion track controllers, and the HTC Vive also has two Steam VR wireless motion track controllers. Or the PlayStation VR can be used with the controllers you may already know, the PlayStation Move controllers. And in theory, there are also standalone VR devices that not only contain the sensors and the lenses and the screens, but also the computing power. At the moment, I would say this is only theory because there are no seriously important devices in the market right now. But of course, I guess there will be because this is maybe the most convenient form to experience virtual reality without plugs or cables, but with a higher computing power than the smartphones. And as I said before, we as developers need to know about these devices and also the concepts of virtual reality if we want to include all users. So let's talk about some of the main important concepts of VR: stereoscopic images and tracking. And we will begin with stereoscopic images. So, when we talk about stereoscopic images in the context of web VR, we are talking about two images next to each other showing the same content, but as you may see, from a slightly different point of view. And the offset of both images corresponds exactly to the distance between our eyes and is called IPD, which means interpupillary distance. So, by showing these images to each eye, we are exactly recreating how we see the world naturally, and our brain combines these images like it always does and gives us the perception of 3D depth. And when we are looking at web VR images, we often see not full screen images like this, but some kind of distorted images like these. We need this effect to compensate the distortion the thick lenses are making to the images, because if we didn't have the distortion, the images would look like this on the right. When we apply a contrasting distortion on the other side to the original image, what we see behind the lenses will be without any distortion again. So, by showing these two slightly different images to each eye, we are already creating an effect of depth. To make our brain believe that we are actually in a virtual space, we also have to include tracking. Most VR devices include 3-degree of freedom tracking sensors for the rotation around the three axes, like here, and more advanced devices, for example, the HTC Vive or the Oculus Rift, also are tracking the position of the user in a room, which is often called room scale VR. You can surely imagine that more tracking sensors will intensify the feeling of actually being present in a virtual space. And this is why we also want to include input controllers with rotation and position tracking sensors in the experience. Okay, now, how do we create such experiences with JavaScript? I will first show you the stack we will be working with. So, first of all, there's of course the browser. And then with WebGL, we have a JavaScript library, API, sorry, for rendering GPU accelerated 3D graphics in the browser. And to include access to the head-mounted display and its sensors, there's the experimental API WebVR. And on top of this, there may be further JavaScript libraries. There's one common library to reduce the effort of writing WebGL, which is called FreeJS, and I guess many of you have heard of. I will show you these techniques now with a super simple example. So here we have a spherical and obviously distorted video that I recorded last week, with my full field camera. And what we want to do is play this spherical video undistorted and in a stereoscopic way. So we also want to use the tracking sensors, or more precisely the rotation sensors, to let the user look around while the video is playing. So our setup could look like this. We see a three-dimensional coordinate system where the camera is the user. And around the user, we will create a large sphere, which will be our video canvas. A simplified version of the code could look like this. If you are familiar with WebGL or here FreeJS, you'll see nothing new. This is only FreeJS. First, we create the scene and the camera, and then we create the sphere and its video texture, and at the end, we render it all to the canvas within a render loop. So this is only WebGL and no WebVR at the moment. But how do we render this scene? Not on the default canvas, but on a head-mounted VR display. This is when the WebVR API comes into play. So first, we need to get access to the VR device, and therefore we use the Navigator interface extension getVRDisplays. It will return a promise that resolves in an array of VR display objects, and a VR display object represents exactly one VR device and holds information about it. For example, if it is currently connected, if it is currently presenting, or it has methods like get eye parameters or request animation frame. And we can now use the VR display object to render content to the head-mounted display using the request present method. Request present takes an array of VR layer objects as an attribute, which all have a property source containing the HTML5 canvas we used to draw on. And the cool thing is RequestPresent handles device-specific rendering issues, like, for example, the barrel distortion I've talked about, so we don't have to implement this manually. And another thing you have to know is that RequestPresent, for security reasons, may only be triggered by user interaction. So you might compare RequestPresent to the RequestFullScreen method. It also requires a user interaction, and RequestPresent first requests that the VR device goes full screen. RequestPresent also returns a promise that is fulfilled when the presentation has begun, and this is the time when we can start the render loop by using the method requestAnimationFrame. VR Display's request animation frame is equivalent to Windows request animation frame, but it has specific features for rendering on a head-mounted VR display. It will also allow us to draw continuously on the canvas, but it is able to do this in a higher frame rate, not only with 60 frames per second, but depending on the headset, with 90 or 120 frames per second. Okay, within the render loop, we are first scheduling the next frame's callback. And then we can update our scene and camera position and rotation depending on the VR display's tracking sensors. And therefore, we have different interfaces. There is the getPose method, which returns a VR pose object with a lots of sensor information from exactly that moment. There's, for example, the user's orientation, which is basically the rotation and which returns a quaternion, or the user's position, which returns a 3D vector. And on a mobile device, like the Google Cardboard, for example, the position is obviously null because, like I said before, this headset does not have any sensors to check where a user is in the room. Then, to render our scene twice, in a stereoscopic way, we use the getEyeParameters method. It gives us all the information we need if we pass a string for each eye as an argument. There is, for example, the offset, which is 1/2 of the interpupillary distance, or there are the render width and the render height, which return the recommended width or height for each eye's canvas. And with this information, we can update the camera and the scene and render it all to the canvas by using the submit frame method, which draws exactly one frame to the canvas. And this is basically all to get the video playing and updating while the user changes her pose. Now, take a look at this. You may have already guessed it, and you're right. The WebVR API isn't ready today. You can see that only Edge, Firefox, Chrome for Android, and the Samsung Internet Browser support some kind of WebVR. Who knows the Samsung Internet Browser? Try it out. It's a cool browser for mobile. All the others, so basically all. But back to VR. In Edge, the WebVR support is basically support for mixed reality for HoloLens. I saw a HoloLens. It's cool. You should try it out. It was there or where. Firefox only supports WebVR at the moment per default on Windows, and Chrome on Android supports Google Daydream for Google Daydream ready phones or cardboards. And there's the Samsung Internet Explorer that adds support for the Gear VR on Samsung phones. And finally, you can enable the WebVR API behind Flex in Chrome or use Firefox Nightly or Developer Edition. Of course, there will be wider support in the future, and fortunately, as long as the API isn't shipped with our modern browsers, we can use the WebVR polyfill. One few words about cross-browser support in WebVR. In a perfect world, our apps run within every browser, but of course, with less features in older browsers. So, a non-WebGL browser would get a static image, I guess, and a browser capable of WebGL gets a 3D WebGL application working with mouse and keyboard. And on mobile devices, we can make use of the touch input, or more important, the gyroscope, to create a more engaging application. And then a browser capable of WebVR, of course, gets the full experience with all WebVR features. One issue with WebGL and WebVR apps is definitely the long loading time because of large images, even larger videos and models and textures. So you want to include mechanisms like progressive loading, for example. And what we saw until now was a lot of code to create a really simple WebGL or WebVR scene. And writing your apps with WebGL or even with Vue.js, like I did here, means you have to write a lot of JavaScript. This is one reason why there are libraries that try to reduce the effort of writing WebGL or Vue.js. First, there's A-Frame by Mozilla, and then there's ReactVR by Facebook. And I will tell you some brief words about both of these libraries. Let's begin with A-Frame. A-Frame is based on HTML, and provides a declarative, extensible, and composable structure to Vue.js. And this is what they call an entity component system. To get started with A-Frame is pretty simple. I don't say simple, really. I don't like to say simple, but it is simple at this time. So you just need to include the script and an A-Scene tag to set up the VR scene. And inside the scene, you'll either work with predefined components in HTML, like we do here, or you can write your own components in JavaScript. Ephraim has other cool features. There are a lot of components, for example, geometric components like a ring or a cone or a torus or things you can't even pronounce. And there are other components to create spatial sound, include 3D models or a skybox. There are many more other cool features and we don't have the time to take a look at them all, but I can only recommend that you try out Ephraim. Check it out for yourself. It has a good docs and some glitch and CodePen starter kits and a really awesome visual inspector for your 3D scenes. Now, React VR by Facebook, it also tries to reduce the effort of writing WebGL and WebVR. And like Ephraim, it is built on top of FreeJS and the WebVR polyfill, but it also relies on the concepts of ReactJS and React Native. So instead of writing HTML, you will write JavaScript and JSX. Here, this is our full sphere video example in React VR. As in Ephraim, React VR already includes a video panel component with a source property that we can use to locate the video and display it in the web VR scene. And it is nested in a view component which acts as a container and provides support, for example, for touch input, layout features, and styling. Similar as Ephraim, React VR provides predefined components for VR application, for example, geometric forms in the first line, or lights, or a VR button that normalizes click and gaze events for headsets that don't support clicks. Speaking about clicking and gazing and input methods, I think you all can imagine that typing into a keyboard with a headset on or even pointing at single keys with an input isn't the best way to make text input. This is why good VR applications, in my opinion, often use more APIs than the ones I've just shown you. First of all, there's the Gamepad API, which is already shipped in modern browsers, but will get more extensions to handle virtual reality-specific features, like, for example, the Gamepad hand to discover in which hand the gamepad lies, or the Gamepad pose interface to get the position, orientation, velocity, and acceleration of a gamepad. And we may also not forget the Web Audio API that we can use to apply spatial sounds to our application. And last but not least, there's the Web Speech API we can use to make text to make input better than with a keyboard. Now, the problem of input is only one example, but overall, I think we should take a closer look at UX design for virtual reality, because the way we interact with the digital world changes dramatically in VR or in 3D. Bo Cronin, I don't really know if I spell the name right, Bo Cronin has created the hierarchy of needs in virtual reality, which I find very compelling and a good guideline to prioritize our focus when creating VR applications. And the hierarchy shows that comfort and interpretability are the most important needs in VR, and only afterwards comes usefulness and delightness of an application. So comfort means that a user can use your application without feeling unwell. And interpretability means that the virtual world feels convincing to the user. If both needs are satisfied, the user will get this feeling of actually being present in the virtual world. And this is what we want to achieve. So, since we cannot talk about all four needs, I want to focus on comfort and begin with some basic facts about ergonomics. We are right now in a kind of similar situation like we were 2007 or 8 when the iPhone and with it the first mobile sites appeared. Back then we had to reconsider how we present information on a tiny screen or on screens with various sizes and ratios. And now we have to think about how we present content to our user when there's no more separation between the user and the content. Our users are finally in our application. And therefore, A VR application does not have a limited viewport. On the contrary, there's an infinite canvas, but a user has a limited field of view. And this field of view, of course, may change because a user can rotate her head and look around. Some smart people found out how big this field of view actually is. If a user is sitting, she can see a 70-degree circle in front, and when turning the head comfortably around 30 degrees, or with stretching to max 80 degrees, the range a user sees increases to 230 degrees. Of course, we could bend and turn around much more, but that means that the main content should be within this range if we want the user to engage with it without effort. Another fact we have to remember is that we have the best depth experience if the content is not more than 20 meters away and not closer than half a meter, because everything closer than 50 centimeters will make us cross-eyed. And since the devices at the moment have a relatively low amount of pixels per degree, we also have to use a large font size. Most designers agree that it should be more than 20 pixels. But, of course, in a 3D space, 20 pixels is a size that doesn't really say anything about the perceived font size. Because how the font size is perceived is depending on where the font is in space and where the user is located. So the further away the text is located, the smaller it will be perceived. I guess you all know this phenomenon, quite likely. So a unit like pixels is not the best to describe font sizes in 3D or VR. And this is why Chris McKenzie, a UX designer from Google, introduced a new size unit at Google I.O. this year. It is called DMM, which means distant independent millimeters, and can be used to describe font sizes independent from the distance they are perceived. I won't go further into detail here, but I put a link to the YouTube video from Scott McKenzie at Google I.O., and there's also a tool called Size Calculator you can use to convert points and millimeters and DMMs. Okay, one last word about PPD, which means pixels per degree. The devices at the moment have around 10 or 12 PPD. A good resolution to not see any pixels anymore and to not worry about anti-aliasing of our font size would be 60. So there's a way to go before we can get legible text and use small font sizes in 3D. Okay, now we know where to put our content to make it comfortably visible for a user. What more can we do to make the user comfortable? There are some best practices you can follow when creating a VR application. First, always provide some kind of feedback. The feedback can be visible or haptic or, for example, like vibrating controllers, or it can be made of spatial sound, or even you can use all this stuff combined together. And you should also consider the use of a reticle with different states for idling, hovering, and active states. Then you will want to guide your user's attention with gaze cues, and therefore you could use spatial audio, or lightning, or color, or even, and it works good, virtual creatures with eyes that will catch the user's attention. And finally, you should bring your old UX patterns all into question. So, how should a menu or a switch or a button look like in 3D? At my company, we try to get insights about this by using the example of an image gallery. So, how would an image slider look if the user wasn't staring on a flat screen, but could be in the application? And I think the VR web comes hand in hand with losing all these UX design metaphors, because we all agreed that an image gallery, of course, would be a gallery with images in the VR web. So this is our gallery prototype. User can look around and gaze at the buttons and move and see all the pictures. Yeah. There are more best practices you can follow to make your users comfortable. We can avoid eye strain by using darker colors, and we should avoid going from dark to bright too quickly because it will make your users glare. Then we should avoid focusing on different depths, and we can avoid creating environments that may trigger phobias like large empty rooms or small rooms or hates messy spaces, underwater environments, and so far. We should always use correct scales, and we do not want to move things fast towards the camera, especially sharp or dangerous or gross things. And we do not want to attach things near or directly to the camera. So a head-up display, as cool as it may sound, is not the right way to use in VR. If you are considering using a splash screen also, for example, put it in a room and not attach it to the camera. Okay. What about the elephant in the room when we talk about comfort and virtual reality? What about simulation sickness? Making your users feel sick, causing them physical pain, or making him or her even throw up is hopefully the last thing you want to do as a developer. So how can we avoid causing motion sickness, or better, simulation sickness? Simulation sickness occurs when our sensory inputs are not consistent. For example, when the simulation tells us that we are in a car race, but we are actually just sitting still in a room. And there are also some best practices you can regard to avoid causing simulation sickness. First of all, don't use acceleration. Constant velocity is okay because we humans cannot feel it, but acceleration and deceleration, so something like this, should be felt, and when there's no feeling, simulation sickness will occur eventually. Also, do not move the horizon and do not force movement to the user, which means do not move the camera directly. So if you want to add some animations, do not animate the camera, because the camera is the user's. For example, put the camera on a dolly and then animate the dolly's movement. Also, always keep head tracking and watch out for low latency and a high frame rate. And avoid flicker and blur, because both indicate movement. And consider adding a stable focus point. For example, some use a stable grid, or some prefer this thing of adding a virtual nose. It should reduce the possibility of simulation sickness. Then also consider to make your application support short uses, which means you should save states or make it offline capable. And consider the use of more abstract or unknown patterns than realistic ones. For example, flying controllers or cartoon hands work way better than realistic arms and hands. Or another example is that a walking simulation will make more users sick than a flying spaceship simulator. And this is all because our brain knows really good how walking or our arms and hands should feel like, and only a slight difference can make it confused and then probably sick. So, if you like it or not, as a developer or a designer, you are at least partly responsible for the well-being of your users. And with a VR web, we as developers are not only responsible for a low battery or high telephony costs anymore. With a VR web, we may cause actual physical and psychological pain. We talked about throwing up, and a user could also run into walls or fall. And I mean, I know it looks really funny, but do we really want to be responsible for our users' injuries? I guess not. Even worse, we could trigger paranoias and not prevent that abusive or scary material will be placed directly in front of a user's eye. This is all... it's all way more serious in 3D, truly, because we are trying to make our users think that they are actually in another world, and then this world hurts them. So, I always like to mention a study the end of the talk, to end on a kind of positive note. There is this study that let people be a superhero in VR and then put these people and other people in a similar situation where someone needed help, accidentally dropped pencils from the floor. And those people who were a superhero in VR actually helped more often and faster than the others. So you see that your content and how it is presented matters a lot. And this is why you all as developers and designers matter a lot. So go build cool stuff with WebVR, but be responsible and be aware. For you to read later, I have a list of resources you could check out if you're interested in WebVR. And you also see at the top left, there's a bit.ly link, which leads to a sign-up form for my WebVR newsletter I'm curating. So if you're interested in this stuff, go subscribe and check it out. And I guess I'm a bit early, but that's all. So thanks for your attention.
Thank you. All right. Thank you, Michaela, for a super interesting talk. I haven't heard much about the technicalities of WebVR, and I found it was a really good intro to the whole topic. If you want to ask questions to Michaela, go and find her in the coffee break, which is actually upcoming. So you actually have.